3, 2, 1.
Hit it.
Experience 24 hours of head-to-head AWS sessions from around the world.
Mic check. 1, 2.
Josh Pankrishon. 2021. Up till down.
Hello, everyone. I'm here to tell you about the lessons I've learned building an 100 million event serverless with a serverless data pipeline. And I'm happy to be here at Josh Pankrishon. I'm Luca Bianchi. I'm Chief Technology Officer of New Experience. And Chief Technology Officer at Whiskey and AWS Serverless Hero and AWS Community Builder. So I am proud to talk to you about serverless today. And I am here to tell you about a product that we have built, which generates events from the browser. So it's a client JavaScript library that sends the backend a couple of events generated by users. So basically the idea is that whenever a user interacts with a web page, it produces three different kinds of events. It makes low-level events, which are events in response to mouse touch events, and they are agnostic. So they are produced by every kind of website, and it's just user interacting with the page. And then we have mid-level events, which are events related to web page actions and are bounded to a specific domain context. So e-commerce has its own events, then publishing or fashion has its own events. And then high-level events, which are structured custom-specific events that are specific to a closed domain. And when you are browsing, we are generating events during browsing, you are subject to a lot of constraints if you want to track these events. Response time is one of them, because we needed to use WebSocket or web browser beaconing, which is an ancient technology, which is an old technology supported by browsers that did not support WebSockets. Then you can have a high value, high volume of data. So millions of events can be sent within a single month, and thousands or 10,000 of events can be sent to the backend within a single minute. And then you can have a very high throughput. So you can have even speak of thousands of events per second. So basically the idea was to build a data processing pipeline that could collect and process events through a set of predefined stages. And our idea was to be able to build a user inside ingesting services in order to analyze these events, and analyzing these events, being able to detect whether or not a user belongs to a specific cluster. So finally, the idea was to be able to classify user behavior and provide tailored support and provide tailored content to users. Then the first part, which is the part that we are going to discuss today, is related to the event ingestion. But we have to remember that it is followed by the convert stage, in which events are converted to meaningful insights, and the final analytics phase, in which events are aggregated and processed by machine learning. But the main issues rely on the ingest phase, because while ingesting, your endpoints are hidden by a huge number of events, a huge number of data. And so we headed for a serverless microservice architecture following the quite pretty standard architecture, which is made of API gateway, then Lambda function processing the events, and finally a database that could handle this kind of events. And we were undecided about the kind of data store that we could use. So we thought about our serverless or maybe DocumentDB, but finally we choose to use DynamoDB because DynamoDB is a great choice when you need to store a huge number of events. But here comes the first lessons that we have to learn in the hard way. The first lesson was related to the fact that using DynamoDB as analytics database is not the right choice. Dynamo is great if you have a clear idea of the access pattern. Whenever your pattern to access data is not clear, DynamoDB is difficult to handle. And pulling data out from DynamoDB is quite difficult if you have more than 60 gigabytes of data per month and more than 130 million data points for each month to be pulled off. Then we failed back to S3 and we moved our data store from DynamoDB to S3 because S3 is faster. It is not going to impose any kind of data accessing layer or data accessing pattern, and it is nearly 99% available, and it is also cost effective. So streaming data to S3 is great, but we needed a service being able to stream data out to S3 because we could not handle that using Lambda, because Lambda couldn't handle the throughput needed to store the bunch of data that we were receiving. So we decided to use Kinesis Firehose in order to push data down to S3. And it was great, but the second lesson that we learned here was that you have to choose your data partitioning scheme wisely, because it strictly depends on the kind of operation that you are going to do after that. And then we start looking into our Lambda and we start thinking about what happened with our Lambda, because we detected that we were missing some events on our data store, and we were thinking ourselves, we're asking ourselves where this event were falling. And the answer was that was achieved by looking to a Lambda metrics. And the answer was that the Lambda error count sometimes ramped up to more than one case, 1,000 events on the lost per minute or per hour, because it was related to the fact that having a lot of the Lambda executing concurrently was something that could not be handled by the cold start of the Lambda function. Moreover, analyzing the pattern of concurrent execution, we have seen that we had peaks within a few seconds, within a single minute, and it resulted in some kind of quite difficult to predict pattern, because it is just a few days, and it changes completely, shifting from 1 week to the other. Then the third lesson that we learned was related to the fact that we needed to use Lambda to transform data, not to transport data. So basically the idea was to be able to avoid cold start at all, by just removing the Lambda and attaching Kinesis Firehose directly to API Gateway. And it was great because with API Gateway, we could directly map to Amazon Kinesis, and we could use API Gateway methods to map to Kinesis Firehose. Also, we could transform data using map data using Velocity templates. Velocity templates are a great tool to be used in order to convert data and to match data. We could also have event validation directly at the API level layer in order to be able to validate the event and to decide whether or not that event could be accepted. And we could also be able to implement fan-out strategies depending on the different kind of usage that we needed to do and the different kind of event types. So we were able to add a bit more to our architecture. We were able to use Kinesis Data Stream and Kinesis Data Analytics to dispatch events to different Kinesis Data firewalls. And this allowed us to use raw, to push raw events directly to S3, then to use Kinesis Analytics to apply event counting and basic statistical analytics, and then store them as well to S3 and push through firewalls high-level events into Amazon Elasticsearch, which is now called OpenSearch. This was a really good choice, and you can start using this very same architecture, which is a serverless architecture and also a lambda-less architecture, focusing on the AWS documentation, which explains in great details how you can map using Velocity from API Gateway to firewalls. And there is a great post from Alex Casalboni, developer advocate at AWS, that explains how to use Kinesis Analytics to implement a fan-out strategy. But we could also improve our architecture because we could also map directly from API Gateway to directly to firewalls, or with a rule select whether to map to Kinesis Data Stream, and finally implement the fan-out strategy. So split the event at the using Velocity templates, which is extremely powerful even to implement event routing. And adopting this improvement could lead to a different cost approach. And we were able to substitute and to pull Kinesis the Data Stream and Kinesis Data Analytics out from the pipeline, because the main problem with Kinesis Data Store is that you are not able to scale up and down the Kinesis Stream in a serverless way. And it is quite a bit cumbersome to manage the Lambda function, to manage the events downstream. So we were able to use for medium-level events Amazon AWS SQS and then Lambda to push events down to S3. And since they were not raw events, they were in a few number, were fewer events, because we were dispatching low-level events directly to S3. We were just using Lambda to manage mid-level events, and it was affordable with a Lambda function. And finally, we were able to pull also high-level events out from the architecture and send them directly to Amazon Elasticsearch. So this is the idea. This is the kind of lessons that we learned using serverless to process 150 million events per month with our customers. And basically, the lessons that we were able to learn were related to one, do not use Lambda to transport data, but only transform data. Second, choose the right database, because starting with DynamoDB, it's a great pattern. DynamoDB is a great database, but the main problem is that if you don't know exactly how you are going to pull that data, how you are going to access that data, it will be cumbersome. It will be difficult to do that. Maybe sometimes, or in many times, if you are doing big data analytics, S3 is a better choice than DynamoDB. And third, when you embrace a fully serverless architecture, when you embrace all, when you make all your services work at their best, using in our case API Gateway with Velocity templates, makes you able to improve all the part of your architectures. So thank you very much. It has been a pleasure, and have a great conference. Have a great day.
The way that you move and how the